I'm going to continue on Jack's talk in a sense by touching mostly on commonly used drugs that were not developed to deal with the issue of cancer at all. Nevertheless, I added some slides after Jacques asked me yesterday to touch also a little bit on genetics, etc. So the flow might not be this is okay. Okay, so I'll rush through some of the points that Jack already made, but we really look at prevention as being behavioral, medicinal, and surgical, the different elements. And behavioral, of course, is all these elements written there: smoking, nutrition, physical activity, reproductive habits, etc. It's anything we do and influences our risk of cancer. A medicinal means that we're going to take a drug in order to prevent, and it can be either drugs that Jack has been talking about, which were designed to the special question, maybe, or commonly used drugs that I'll be concentrating on. And of course, there's all this issue of surgical prophylactic surgery. And I'll say something about it too in a minute. One could consider screening for precancerous lesions as actually a primary prevention activity and not a secondary prevention, because we're looking for precancerous tissues. Unfortunately, and I say it as a public health person, people are not very happy to change their behavior. We keep sending out messages all the time on a million topics, and you will usually find the 5-10% of the population that will respond to you. But even in an element like smoking, where the data is like, could never be better than that, you still see smoking rates that are unbelievable in many Western countries. So people don't like to change behaviors. Our efforts should actually be into introducing the right behaviors at a very right age, early age, rather than try to take somebody and change behaviors. On the other hand, people very much like to take medications. You know, it's like a nice hobby. You go and, you know, you go to the pharmacy and, you know, you start comparing how long your list of medications is. If it's longer, of course, it's an advantage. And so it's actually kind of naturally acceptable to think that, okay, so you take another drug, you know, when you end up in older ages. Some of you have not reached it yet, but yes, it starts growing with age. And of course, surgical options are never popular, you know. And the advantage of thinking about commonly used drugs is that we have a lot of information about them. You'll see me talking about aspirin, statins, etc. There are tens of millions of users in the world. So there's no issues of safety anymore. We just have a lot of data about them for other purposes. Okay, they're also very cheap. Most of them are generic, which is a two-sided sword in a sense, because the fact that they're generic means also that the industry is not really interested in them. So if we need the help of industry to push some of these medications forward, nobody wants to deal with it. I was trying to design a polypill for a study in Africa, and took me a year and a half to find some manufacturer in India that was ready to take a pill that includes aspirin, statin, and, you know, metformin, or maybe vitamin D. Nobody wants to. None of the drug companies wants to put a head into these drugs and combinations. So naturally, who do we want to go to? Again, Jack alluded to it. We want the high-risk groups. Okay, it's a question mark on whether we really want to mess up with the average risk groups who are much higher in proportion. But again, with commonly used drugs, I many times refer to it as a natural experiment, because so many people are taking aspirin and statins, just already taking in the tens of percents of an older population, that in a sense, we're touching on a lot of the average risk population and not only limited to the high risk. And the high risk groups can be either genetic-based groups, and I'll develop that in a second, or people who have specific behaviors or markers, obese, smokers, have dense breasts, and everything that you've already heard about before. And the whole idea here is, of course, to have a drug that does more good than harm. Okay, so you always match the degree of risk of your patient and the degree of aggressiveness of your treatment. That is always true. In prevention, it's especially true, because in clinical treatment, we allow ourselves to go wild because we're like saving the life of the person who is sick. Here, the people are healthy. You need to be much more careful not to ruin their lives with treatments that might have even relatively simple side effects. Okay, a lot of markers, a lot of risks to breast cancer. You've seen most of it already too. And the one that I'm going to touch on now is genetics. And again, per Jack's request. A lot of genes involved. I'm sure everybody in the audience can quote BRCA, BRCA, you know that there's a discussion where BRCA came from. You know, is it Berkeley, California, or breast cancer? You know, where Mary King discovered it, or breast cancer, you know? So anyway, everybody calls it BRCA, like a good friend. And but you see, there are many more genes. I don't have a pointer to actually use it. But on the left side, we have the ones that are relatively rare, but carry very high relative risk. On the left side, on the right side, we have those that are much more common, but carry low level risks, and what we call low penetrance. So again, high penetrance, low risk, low penetrance, high risk. These games between these genes always go on, and genes change their places on this graph according to accumulating data. And it's very interesting. I took this slide from a presentation a week ago in City of Hope, and that somebody else prepared for me, and there are at least two or three elements here that I just do not agree with. I think they're mispositioned. It's a developing world, okay? So while you look at all these, what you actually test in practice and refer to many times is just the BRCAs. But there's so much more than just the BRCAs. And I'm just showing two things that we have published recently, MUTYH, that is usually related to APC, to polyposis. We find, again, in the right corner, you can see a twofold increased risk of breast cancer that we find in our North African populations. Very interesting, we don't find any mutation in our Ashkenazi population. It's one of the rare events where there's been a full block of a mutation in a population. You know, I've tested 10, 20,000 people and not found one mutation, when the average European prevalence is about 2.5%. So it's, but we find it much more commonly among the North African people, but very gene related. Another gene we reported recently in Cancer Discovery is with Ken Offit from Memorial, is the ER3CC3. So these are new genes with a relative risk of about 2. So it's not 1.1, it's not 1.3, it's about 2. And a fair population frequency that you have not seen in the graph that I showed before. So these databases keep updating themselves. And again, you see, that's a slide. It's not it's not right for the Jewish Ashkenazi population, but it's right for a lot of the Caucasian population, where you see that there's a big chunk of the BRCA1s, BRCA2, and a lot of these P10, P53, ATM, CDH, PALB2, and all these. And then you see the chunk of the SNPs that is estimated that is not that small, and that is before the recent reports on about 70 newer SNPs for breast cancer that came out last week in Nature and Nature Genetics. So this would probably add another piece to that, okay? So it's very hard for me today to answer what fraction of breast cancers is actually gene-driven. Very hard to answer. And I would say that while we were talking about up to 10%, with all the SNPs, if we manage to develop, let's call it a haplotype of these SNPs or combinations that will actually show the risk, we might go up to maybe even 15 and 20% of all breast cancers being demonstrated with regards to our genetic events. BRCA is clearly the leading element. We've studied BRCA extensively. I personally have about 2,500 carriers in the clinical service that I provide with BRCA. It is, because I have a microphone in my hand, it is an opportunity to say that being a carrier of BRCA is not a death sentence. And we should not refer to these women as if they're going to die. And I think that our behavior towards these women is extremely aggressive. You know, we're over-treating them. I would say of 2,500 carriers, maybe 35% are breast cancer cases. The rest are healthy, and they're healthy, and they can get healthy to the age of 70 and 80. I do not promote bilateral mastectomy unless I have a reason to do so. It's not reflex, it's not automatic. There's people behind the story, and you need to refer to their needs, to the real risks. And you have to remember that my job is a little easier because practicing in a founder population, I know the differences between the specific mutations we have in hand. In a general population, it's harder when you don't have founders because you refer to every mutation with the same power. But the penetrance of the mutation changes. It's not the same to every mutation. A 185 del AG is maybe at 40% penetrance, maybe 45%. The 5382 is at 80%. These are different behaviors to different patients. And the 5382 in Israel is, or in New York, is 80% penetrance. But in Poland, for some reason, it's only 20% penetrance, which means that there's also all these epigenetics. The same mutation does not necessarily give the same risk. And you know, I mean, what shows us how stupid we are is the fact that after 20 years of handling these genes, still, if I have 10 women who carry the same 185 del mutation, the best I can tell them is that half of you will get cancer and half of you would not. So you know, I mean, how intelligent are we that we can't tell who will and who will not, okay? So really, I mean, we have a long way to go, and some of it is really embarrassing. I feel very embarrassed when I say it to women, and I have to say it almost every day, okay? So an exercise we just did and just reported on, not in the literature yet, just in a conference, is we took 300 women who are under 35 with breast cancer. And we try to see what we see in them with regards to genetic events. I mean, mutations, pathogenic mutations. And remember, in a founder population, excluding the founder carriers, there was no need to do. And we ran big panels of them, panels of 700 genes and more. And you see, we got a plethora of findings. We have actually 17% of these women had mutations beyond the founders, okay? And the big players were CHK2, some BRCA2 that we did not recognize before, ATM, We actually have very interesting events, and some of them, even in genes that, like NBN and other, that are not necessarily known as, you know, breast cancer genes. So we see AIP, we see RINT, we see NBN. Before we did the panels, we never encountered them. But they're there, and they're pathogenic in behavior. So you need to remember that there's a huge genetic world out there beyond BRCA. You know, we stop at BRCA, probably wrong. We're running a big study in Israel. It's called Bikinis. It's Breast Cancer in Northern Israel study. A lot of publications already. Until now, it's a population-based. It's case control. I mean, I'm running through it. The controls are randomly chosen from the population. This is what we teach in school to do, okay? This is designed exactly according to all the rules. We interview the people, 850 questions or more, on everything you can think about. You know, very exhausting to both ends, the interviewer and the interviewee. We take biological samples as much as we can from wherever we can. The outcome of it is that I today have 400,000 aliquots in my freezers. A lot of takes a lot of room and a lot of handling, okay? And we have every possible record. So we will have mammography records, we will have medical records, oncology records, pathology records. We will have every possible record of the patient, and we will do full follow-up and have vital statistics on every one of these cases. It's a major effort, and we have more than 15,000 women on this effort, okay? It's a huge resource, huge, and needs to be taken, you know, be used very carefully not to exhaust samples for just simple, non-important questions, okay? But really big, I mean, 8,000 women, and the consecutive women, the population-based, they're it, and can really help answer quite a lot of questions, okay? I will skip that. And then we go to what I was supposed to have been talking about and have only very little time left to, but which are the drugs that are on our agenda for with regards to possibly having anti-cancer activity. I'm not touching on all of them, I'm only touching on some, but aspirin is one example. When I show you tables like that, that means that it comes from the case control that we are conducting. So you've just seen it, okay? And by the way, one of the strengths of that study is that it's not relying on people's self-report, but rather on pharmacy data, okay? So it's highly validated pharmacy data. All the drugs in Israel, all the medications, are taken through organized pharmacies that are computerized. It's a unique system. So there's no reason to go to a private pharmacy because there you have to pay, and in the system pharmacies you don't pay. It's free of charge. Okay, anyway, so you can see that what we see here, and again, I don't have a pointer, but the top of the three bottom lines, it's a 0.9 effect, very mild, 10% reduction of breast cancer risk with use of aspirin. And I showed just three of many, many combinations that we have looked at of taking aspirin daily, for any time, taking it only low dose. Most of aspirin users are low dose users. Okay, it's not common to use high dose aspirin. A low dose aspirin daily for any length, taking it daily at least for 3 years. All these, bottom line, everything is 0.9. 10% reduction, and to my, let's call it happiness, when you look at this data of, you know, you have a lot of meta-analysis and a lot of reviews of these subjects, you see that what I marked at the bottom is exactly this 0.9, okay? You see it there in whether it refers to, well, although you say, one has to admit that in the cohort studies you see less of an effect than in the other less classical, I mean, you know, we tend to say the cohorts are better than case controls. I'm not going to go in there. I personally disagree, but doesn't matter. Anyway, it's a 0.9. the same 0.9 we have seen. And if you look here, you see that especially for the ER-positive breasts, not the ER-negative, it's the same 0.9 repeating itself. Okay? So, and what is it here? Ah, okay, when you look at premenopausal, postmenopausal, it's a postmenopausal. Again, the 0.9. Okay? So we need to understand that it's about 10% reduction. Just remember that after the age of 50, I would say that probably 20 to 40, and in some ages even 60 and more, percent of the population take low-dose aspirin daily. So the population effect could be immense, just as a natural experiment, you know, something that we have not planned. Okay? And well, let's keep that. That's a time. Now, there's mechanism behind it, but I don't have time to go into it. And basically, you know, we're trying to block the E2 that is a subproliferation promoter. Statins, similarly, we started the, you know, I have to admit that kind of unknowingly, that's a paper I wrote in the New England from quite a lot of years ago. And we looked at statins and colorectal cancer. It kind of got us interested because we have a parallel study in colorectal cancer also with some 15,000 people. And we found an interesting effect, a preventive effect against colorectal cancer. And since then, I think there have been maybe 10,000 papers on statins and cancer. It's very interesting how you start a trend, you know, without, you know, we just thought it's a nice idea to look at it. Okay, and statins, again, are being used by a lot of the population. And again, in our study, about 10% in breast, much higher in colon, but in breast, about 10% protection here in our study. And again, with statins, you have to talk about a variety. You know, I mean, I was talking about aspirin before. A lot of the aspirin effects can be found also by more selective COX inhibitors. I did not go into it. But here with statins, you have the lipophilic and the hydrophilic, and you have to take into account that most of the data in the world comes from either use of simvastatin or pravastatin, which were the drugs that have been most extensively used. We're not talking about sophisticated third-generation drugs, okay? And again, a plethora of publications. I try to emphasize things, but it's very hard to say anything more than that many or most of the studies have shown some negative association. Okay, we're not allowed to use the term preventive effect because it's not a randomized trial, but it's a negative association. So there must be some there, and some of them are with hydrophilic, and some of them are hydrophilic, and some of them are this and that. But there's a lot of literature now on the subject, and pretty much in agreement with a minor effect, okay? We will be very careful. Now, when you write papers on things, you need to show mechanisms. So one goes to look at mechanisms, okay? And you say, well, what do statins have to do with cancer? And you realize that statins go through the mevalonate pathway. And in the mevalonate pathway, there's a split at some point after some granulation, phenacylation process that takes the process either to cholesterol production or to production of small oncogenic molecules, RAS, RAW, and so on, okay? By blocking it high up, where I marked the statins with a HMG-CoA reductase, you actually block the process. So you gain less production of cholesterol. At the same time, you also gain less production of RAW and RAS, et cetera, therefore less cancer. And once we realized that, we looked at that pathway, and another agent that was lying on that pathway are the bisphosphonates. And the bisphosphonates just block the same mevalonate pathway, but at a lower level. And yes, bisphosphonates also reduce cholesterol, if you go to look in the literature. But of course, were introduced to deal with osteoporosis, nothing to do with cancer, but also block the same place. And again, if you look at the literature of people who are taking both, you see that there is no advantage. So they're just blocking the same pathway. So if you take one or you take the other, or you take them two, the both of them, you get the same effects. Okay, so we went into looking into bisphosphonates, and not knowing that Jack is also interested in the subject, I have to say, in another part of the world. And you know, everybody was sure that it's all effects on the bone. I personally do not think that the anti-cancer effect is through the bone. And you see five or six different mechanisms suggested here. And to be honest, when we suggest five mechanisms, it means that we know nothing. Okay? Because otherwise we would not have suggested five. So everybody was looking at all the basic sciences and said, well, it's doing this, maybe it's that, maybe it's doing this, okay? So we don't take pride on that either, but whichever way we look at it, and again, the different generations of bisphosphonates, how much more time do you give me? I saw a movement on the chairmanship desk. Okay, so we looked at our bisphosphonates. We published our bisphosphonates and postmenopausal breast cancer data because we were relying on a case control study. So who was taking bisphosphonates? Only the women who are, you know, at risk of osteoporosis, or already had osteoporosis. They were all postmenopausal. I cannot answer anything about premenopausal. Okay, it's an observational study. And we came out in 2010 in the JCO with a point estimate of 0.7 and a confidence interval of 0.6 to 0.9. And in a very interesting way, or just by chance, the WHI study, Chlebovsky, came out in the same JCO issue with exactly the same point estimate, 0.7, 0.5 to 0.9. Okay, we were also speaking back to back in San Antonio in this in 2010. You know, there was a whole noisy event, and Polly Newcomb just did not aim at JCO and quietly published in the British Journal of Cancer exactly a month before us, actually. Only that nobody noticed it because it was a minor journal. But she published the same results on the same, you know, from another study, okay, in Seattle. Okay, and she also got the 0.7, 0.5 to 0.9. It's fascinating. I think three different studies coming out same day with the exact same result is a rare event. Does it say that it's right? Maybe we're all wrong, you know? But that's what we had in hand. We looked at it by length of use, and we did not see a difference by number of years of use, which I found very interesting and actually very supportive. Because what do bisphosphonates do? They go into the bone, and bone release is very slow. Okay, so once they accumulate in the bone, it takes them 10 years to get out of the bone. Okay, that's why we can give them long term. And think of it, if we could give bisphosphonate to a woman, okay, and know that for 10 years she is protected at that degree of protection, it's wonderful. It is wonderful. Is it right? I don't know. It's very hard to take it into a randomized trial, but we at least two people here in the audience think that it needs to be done. Okay? But think of it, it's a classical prevention. You give an injection or whatever method you want to do, and you get protected for 10 years at a level of 0.5, 0.6? Unbelievable, okay? So it's a very strong candidate, and models, you model it this way, that way, it doesn't matter. It's sturdy, it stands there. And what is more interesting, not more, but support, even more interesting, is it also supports and helps survival of breast cancer women with breast cancer, which is against. You know, you can take a woman and in addition to all the chemos, just give her some simple drugs that will not ruin her life compared to all the stuff she's getting. But we actually can show very significant reduction in mortality. And I just published it actually. I don't even remember where, but it's published now. Okay, I'm sorry. I just don't remember anymore. And that's the literature in the world. And I'm going and here actually, Jack was mentioning the contralateral breast as a trigger to find chemopreventive agents. And here I'm writing an editorial to JNCI on a paper that I marked here by Monsies, who reported a strong reduction in contralateral breasts. So again, we have the same theme going along here. Metformin, I don't have time, I'll run through it. Mechanisms, again, plenty mechanisms we don't know. But when we look at the drug, we again get an effect of about 15% reduction in risk of breast cancer. It's more controversial, the more studies, and some hint towards a length effect, that so you need to take it for like 3 or 4 years before you see effects. Okay, and that of course reflects the international literature, because some have looked at long term, some have not. And of course, but I marked a bunch of them that have actually shown an effect. Conclusion. We need to identify the women who are candidates for what we could call risk reduction drugs or chemoprevention. And aspirin statins are these mild tools which are already used by many. Second generation bisphosphonates, you don't need to go to the third generation. Fancy ones are clearly associated with reduction in risk and improved survival. Metformin is still somewhere hanging there. And actually, we have a paper that is under review now on that. We'll see what it does to the literature. And really, this is an approach that is very helpful, I think. The problem with that, and the reason that it's not in our guidelines, is that you cannot do randomized controlled trials of drugs that are commonly used because of the contamination of your control group. It's technically very tough, okay? And that is a big issue. I'll just finish by saying we're planning on having a genetics meeting, out of the box meeting in Haifa in October 18, which will deal with a lot of the issues that I've mentioned here. And if you have never heard of Haifa, this is what it looks like. You should definitely come. This is Haifa, okay? And it's right, Jack, not to go to Haifa. It's wrong, right? He was there. Yeah, so here's Haifa. That's our medical school right there sticking out. And that's our beach on the Mediterranean. Okay, thank you very much.